Alrighty, I think it's about time to get started. I actually have heard from several people that they're interested to find out where they can get the source code. I might be able to give the source code for this loot system we're building together publicly, but I'm not giving the entire RailPoor system publicly. There's some certain things in there that other developers working on that are proprietary and we can't be sharing right now, but I have some steps for you as far as how you can get your own copy of a working server and easily get it up and running. So in fact, I wanted to run through it real quick with you so that you have an idea what you will expect when you're trying to get the server going. So let's do a little bit of what is it called? Let me Google that for you, right? I love this site. It's hilarious. So Visual Studio Express. This is what you want if you don't have it yet. Let's see, click a button. Okay, creating. Now we have we can preview. So I could have given you this link and you would have seen this beautiful video of the computer Googling it for you, and here's the answers. So you're probably looking for downloads or Visual Studio Express, obviously the first one. So apparently there's a new edition, but basically you want to get the free Visual Studio. Visual Studio Express is what it's historically been called. I don't know if, you know, with Windows 10 they're giving like a new version or whatever, but anyway, it's free and it's really handy. It can do everything that you've seen me do, of course, and so you need to get that. If you don't have an Ultima Online client, you need an Ultima Online client, so let me Google that for you. Download. You know, I wonder if they're ever going to stop hosting the older client. I know the true Ultima Online, you know, the one that is run by Broadsword Online now, I think, actually does, come on Google, don't fail me now. It detected me doing a let me Google that for you, and now it's mad at me. Maybe their website's down. If you can't get one of the older clients here, then you can possibly do it in the new. Interesting. I wonder if, I know UO is doing they like made a new website or something. I wonder if, I don't want client download. Come on, people. Come on, internet. Let's see, Game Guide Media. Account. Wow, they really changed this up, man. Holy moly. Whoa. Okay, support. You know, let's see. Getting started. Client download. Hey. Classic client. Yeah, this is what we're talking about. So there it goes. It's downloading 18 megabytes worth. It probably is an installer or something. Anyway, you do install that. You're going to need something that can help you connect to free servers because you're starting your own free server. So look for Razer Ultima Online. This is one assistant that works, or Yo Steam is another one. So you download it and run it, and then when you run Razer, I'm going to go ahead and, how about I run Razer? So you'll pop up this window. It'll have this auto detect to load the client. If it's not finding it after you've installed the client, then I do have a question. How's your server dealing with the Ultima Online client encryption? So the way that RunUO handles encryption, actually, I'm not sure that it actually does much by default. And I don't know that it's been touched for RailPoor. So, you know, generally, what you would want to encrypt certain important information, a password. You don't generally care about encrypting the motion, you know, like I want to move left and right and whatnot. And you know, I think that technically under the default settings, when you send your password over to the RunUO servers, it's unencrypted. But I haven't, I remember looking into that a long time ago. And I don't know exactly how that could be changed. So that's a great question. I haven't looked into it enough to give you a great answer. I apologize. You can browse to where you put the client. The client usually by default is installed in your C drive, program files, x86. It was in Electronic Arts. I don't know if it would have moved. You see, I have a bunch of different clients in here from different eras and stuff. When I was working on UO Forever and whatnot, they have their own version basically that they're using. And then you'd pick the client.exe that you want to run. And then, of course, the UO data directory is basically the same thing, except you would navigate not to the client folder, or not to the client exe, but to the client folder, which is in the same spot. All right, that kind of stuff. All right, so you'd hit OK. And when you hit OK, assuming you got that set up correctly, look what you got. Looks like you got Ultima Online, and it will look at that IP address. You'll notice I typed in a particular, or I didn't type it in, it was in there by default, 127.0.0.1, and by default RunUO runs on the 2593 port. These are things you can change. You can't change your IP address. Well, technically you could spoof it in some ways, but anyway, your port you can change in the code, right? But 127.0.0.1 always points to your own computer, okay? So I downloaded now the final step. ServUO, I think they run a great service here. They host the ServUO repository, which is RunUO with a few things added. I think like XML spawner, there's some systems that make it much easier to run a Ultima Online server already built in there, which is really nice. So when you click on the repository, it'll bring you here. This looks really intimidating. If you know what you're doing, you do a git clone. Git is a versioning software, which is really helpful actually, especially if you're working on code with other people. It lets you submit changes and other people can review exactly what lines changed, and they can, you know, you can kind of control and see what other people are working on, and it merges them together and things. It's a beautiful thing. If you're not using it with a multiple person project, you really need to. Anyway, you don't have to worry about it, though. You can just download the zip file and you'll get the zip file. I already downloaded it, so we don't have to. I'm already downloaded it again. And inside that zip file is, that's real poor, is this. So you're going to copy this file folder onto your computer somewhere, doesn't really matter where. And so after that, where are we? I put it on my computer somewhere, here it is. Whoop. You'll see this. And after you've installed the Visual Studio, you have this Microsoft Visual Studio solution file. It ends with this .sln. If you don't see the ends of your files, file names, Microsoft hides them because it thinks that you're not smart enough to like use them. Because if you change this to something else, it says it might become unusable. And you say yes, and look, it says it's just a file. It doesn't know what program to use it to open it. We know which program to use to open it. So when you say open, and it says, oh, what do you want to use to open it? You tell it, oh, I know which file. And you can navigate to that executable you want to open it with, like this. And I can open that file, and it opens just fine. But So the Windows tries to protect you from yourself. Of course, if I change it back, then here I am. Fun stuff you're learning with me today. But if you want to make it so that you can see those extensions, you go to you in your Windows Explorer. You press Alt Tools Folder Options View. I like to show hidden folders, but you know you really don't have to. Sometimes it'll catch you when you're doing development and stuff. But hide extension for extensions for file known file types. That's there where you want to change it. Anyway, all right. So we are ready to run our server potentially, unless there's something wrong with. Yeah, this is trustworthy. I trust ServUO. They're good guys over there. So then I'm going to press F6, which is build all. See if it crashes. And it won't crash. It'll tell me some errors if there's some errors. The there's only one place you might need to change in order to run it. You can see it. See the build process in Visual Studio is actually arrows entering a box and turning into circles. That's what we're doing in the background, apparently. So if I hit start, it's going to be like, oh, what's the deal? You don't have a project that has an entry point, basically. You're trying to run a class library. The problem is that by default, it's trying to run the entry point of a particular project, and the scripts project is the first one, so that's the one it's trying to run, and it will not... it is actually set to not create an executable, but rather a library. Basically, a library is just a set of classes and functions, like we talked about before, and it does not have an entry point, so there's not a particular place that a program would start. So it's not executable. That's why it's .exe. It's executable, right? You can run it. The server, however, does have an executable, so what you do is right-click here, and you set to... set a startup project, and now that is my startup project, and it's going to be the one that runs. And wow, they have colors. My version doesn't, and RailPort doesn't have colors. That's because I guess I'm not cool. All right, it says the following module is built either with optimization anywhere without debug information. It's going to give you this warning, apparently, to debug this module. Changed its project build configuration to debug. Oh, okay, so that's something that if you didn't know about, you know, I've been using the debugger a lot. There's some setting in the project settings here that if you don't change to debug, right, then... the configuration to debug, then you that library won't have the symbols and things built into it that the core, when the core is trying to run that library, it won't have access to those symbols it needs to debug. You know, there has to be some extra information in there for you to step through a program. Okay, that's kind of important to know, I guess. So finally, there's only a couple more things here. I'm going to set my server to debug configuration as well. Let's see if that resolves it. I think you might actually need... So you see, I don't have the debug enabled here, I don't think. But real quick, let's create a user account. It's going to ask me. My username is Alan. My password is Alan. That won't get you very far if you try to use it anywhere else. But we actually have the server running. Let me make sure I can at least connect to the server. And we can look at that debug thing in a second. All right, what do we got here? Sidra. I don't know where that came from. Okay, I gotta do my classic Newbert hairstyle. Curly. I gotta do the long beard. All right. This guy is pretty studly looking. You got your server running on your computer now. So you got Ultima Online on your computer running, and you are the administrator, and you can type commands like, let's see, what kind of commands? You can't see them. I need to change my Razer setting. Yeah, I'm going to use YoSteam real quick instead. I'd rather not mess with my Razer settings. All right, you can see it now, I think. So you can do something like add Balron. You put a open bracket and type add and then Balron, and that's a command. You can do that, type add, and it gives you all these things you could in a menu you can look at. I want to add a blue book. Okay, you can do teleport, tele, you can mtele, you can tile Balron, which is like add Balron, but you pick a rectangle and it adds a bunch of Balrons. You can area and then run a command, area kill. So anyway, lots of fun. You have godlike powers, you know. So that's the how to run your own server. That's how to get the scripts if you want to dig deeper into stuff I'm talking about, you can do that. So that's my introduction. I think, what is it that I wanted to do? Post build event, I think it was in command line arguments. So type debug in the server command line arguments, and when you hit play, it didn't give me that warning. So what we can do to make sure everything's good is I'm going to go to Balron. I don't know what it is about Balrons. I think, yeah, I had that again. I don't know what it is about Balrons, but they, you know why I need to create a user account again? It's because I didn't save. But I like Balrons. They're just, you know, like the epitome. Oh, a different server name. I think it might be randomly generating a server name. So let's see if I can. I probably can't. Yeah, so you see it's not. It doesn't have any breakpoints because it's not in a debug mode. You know, I'm not going to worry about figuring that out for now. But I believe it has something to do with the project settings. And I can. I will, I'm going to post these videos to YouTube, and I'm going to put it in the caption when I figure it out. It's going to bother me, though. You know, it's going to bother me for the rest of this broadcast. Alrighty. But, so, you have the tools you need to get your own Ultima Online server, and you can do whatever you want with that. And, there you are. My gift to you. I have really enjoyed playing around with it. I learned an immense amount from it, and I think you will too if you get into it. So, so let's get back to where we were. Where were we? So I think, I don't know, I think it's a pretty lofty, probably naively optimistic goal to finish this loot system that I have been describing to you. Here, let me close that. And have these files that we're parsing and trying to make sense of. But we might be able to finish it within either today or tomorrow. So let's get at it. Where we left off, we just barely finished implementing this for loop that's iterating over every single line of my file. And in each line, it first of all trims it the white space off the end. If it's an empty line, it continues. It doesn't need to process an empty line. It looks for the comment start index, and the first index that it finds with this hashtag. If the hashtag, did I say pound symbol last time? Yeah, hashtag. I don't use Twitter enough, you see. So if it finds one in there, then it trims the line again at that index using the substring command, and then the character it's finding is the first character in the trim line. And the reason that we're grabbing the first character is because we're looking for three particular cases. Because we're at the beginning, we haven't entered one of these loot categories. So of course this is my how I'm doing my loot specification, right? I have a loot category identifier, and then inside that loot category, until I run into another loot category identifier, which is preceded by this dollar sign, I'm going to interpret all that information as specifications for that loot category, right? Magic weapon one, this is that specification. So we need to first find a loot category, and we needed something to tell us that we're inside a loot category as opposed to outside a loot category. So what's a good yes or no thing we can use? A variable that can store that state is a Boolean, of course, and we're going to name it, what is it? Inside specification equals false. So we haven't reached it yet. We haven't got into a specification yet. So if we do run into one of these symbols or one of these ampersands, because the ampersands signify a class, a mobile class, a mob basically, that is going to have a particular loot bag, right? A particular loot table, right? So this is the loot table. You look up the mob in the table and you figure out what loot he drops, okay? And so basically if I run into this symbol, then I know that I am inside the specification. Or if I run inside into this symbol, I also know that I'm inside the specification. The other thing is, we actually don't care what the first character is if we're inside of this specification. Oh, well, wait, we do actually. But we don't, we do care, because if we run into this symbol while we're inside of this specification, right? So follow the logic with me. I ran into this dollar sign. So I'm running through this switch statement on that dollar sign, and I found, okay, I'm going to start my first specification, whether it's a loot category or a mob identifier, okay? So then I basically turn this to true, and everything that happens after that will apply to the specification that I'm currently in, okay? Now, so, but if I run into another item that has a dollar symbol in front of it, then I'm actually going to know that I have reached a new specification. I'm going to have to close what I'm working on and wrap it up and start a new one, right? And so the specification could be is going to decide how this first character responds, right? So first of all, if inside specification, then do one thing. Otherwise, we do another thing, okay? If we're inside the specification, then we're adding to this loot category, okay? If we're outside the specification, then we're starting, we're identifying the name of the specification and then starting to integrate or build that specification, okay? Hope that's making sense. And in fact, we could even do it better than a Boolean flag, because every time we enter a specification, basically we're going to create some space in memory where we're going to start to add information to the specification, right? We run into this, we create, and in fact, last time we went over these objects here, or these classes that we created to store this state for us, to do all the bookkeeping, right? And so this is where we can use that, and we can just use the fact of whether or not there is an object that we're working on and just replace that object when we come across a new one, rather than caring whether or not there's a specification or not. We can do that, and I'm going to show you. I don't know if that made sense or not, but we're going to do it that way. So there's this loot category, is one specification type there is, and another specification type is, of course, this mob type. Okay, so there's a problem though. If I approach it that way, is that if I'm in a I want to have an object that has no dependence. I don't need to know what that object is, I guess is what I'm trying to say. I don't need to know whether it's a loot category or whether it's a mob type, right? I don't want to know. I just want to build that specification into this object, whatever it is. It can be a mob type, or it can be a loot specification, right? So the way that I did that with this base loot object, I kind of did a similar thing to what I'm describing to you now, is I have this base class. I don't think a base class is appropriate because the loot category is actually quite a bit different from, it's not. It's pretty much the same thing, so we could probably get away with it. Let's just do this loot system entry, okay? And, you know, honestly, we don't need much in there except for the ability to add loot objects. Well, the loot objects are going to be shared. And the category name, we can change it from category name to identifier, so that it applies to both the category names and the mob identifiers, okay? Mob type identifiers, okay? So that's what we're going to do. We're going to move that stuff into this base class, and we're going to have loot category inherit from that base class. And in fact, we can even put this in there too. So I guess the only difference then is going to be where, if it's one type versus another, we're going to keep track of them in a separate way, because the mob types are treated separately. The mob types are used when a mob dies. Basically, it goes to my loot system and it asks, okay, Mr. Loot Table, do you have an entry for an ogre type? And that loot is going to respond by handing it back a loot system entry that corresponds to the mob type, right? And that entry for ogre, well, actually, let's use Etten. Well, for ogre, it has this one, okay? And that mob type basically, so we would return this list of base loot objects that we've built, right? To that process, basically. And that process then will execute the spawn functions on each of those and put it in the backpack of the ogre or whatever. Okay, so that's the kind of logic that we're trying to implement here. I hope it's making sense. If you kind of are losing me, ask me a question or ask me to slow down or maybe go over something again. But that's kind of what I'm envisioning in how I'm approaching this. So let's give it a try. You know, there's only one way to figure out if it's going to work or not. And that is to try. So we're going to do not a loot category. We're going to do a mob type specification. All right. So they both inherit from this loot system entry. And we want to have them when you call their constructor with the category name, or why don't we just call it identifier. We want to, I'm copying and pasting, by the way. Copy and paste is your friend, although it gets you into trouble a lot of times because you know, you might copy and paste something with X's and Y, or X's in it, and then you go back and you just change the Y's, but you forget to do it in one spot, and then it's using the X's and it screws you up really bad, and it's lots of fun. Until I've had experience with that. Does not contain a constructor that has zero types. Okay, that's good. So we need to call the base constructor with the category name. And it's not a category name, it's identifier. So the deal with this is, there's only when you inherit from a particular class, You can call the base constructor. So if I want to create a new loot category, and I want it to do what this constructor does, I described constructors last time, but then basically I can do it like this. Is I call the base constructor, and I can pass the parameters that are passed to the loot category constructor, which is the subclass of the loot system entry. So basically, when I call this, when I say new loot category, which I will do very soon, when I tell the computer to make a new one for me so I can start putting stuff in it, in these loot objects, the identifier it'll run this function, but before it does anything in here, it will also come and run this function through this base keyword and pass the identifier as the parameter and identifier. So it'll, before it even gets into here, it'll do this. And I don't know that there's anything else special that we need to do here. So I don't know. The way I've designed this, I'm sure that there's another solution that might be cleaner. But as my one teacher, I had a teacher who taught signal processing, said, the closer to the whiteboard you get, the stupider you get. He would always have people get up and do solve problems on the whiteboard in front of everybody. And that's kind of the way it might work here. So something to remember. The closer you are to the whiteboard, meaning the closer you are, the more people you're doing something in front of, the stupider you get. So I actually think this is going to work just fine. But we will... rather than do an inside specification, right? We will create a loot entry, loot system entry, current entry. So we have a pointer to this. Our currently, we'll set it to null for first. To our current loot entry that we're working on. So this would be if I reached this magic weapon one. We're going to create a new entry, right? So the issue here is, what do we do when we run into a dollar sign? Well, first of all, we need to check if there's something we're currently operating on. So if current entry is not null, then it means that we are in the middle of processing one of these entries. We're in this area. And the only time that current entry is null is when we first enter the file, okay? So if we've reached a dollar sign, it means that we have reached a new specification, a new loot category specifier. There are no multiple, you know, you can't do two and one, hello, and weapon and goo. You know, you can't do like that. You can with the mob specifier, right? We can have multiple on a single line. So we're going to have to handle that a little differently. But let's start one thing at a time, you know? That's kind of the best approach to programming. Well, not always. It's good to think ahead, but we will deal with it. I think it's not going to be that difficult to fix. So we are going to... You're doing great. Thanks. I appreciate the compliment. If you have any questions or you want me to slow down or explain something, let me know. So we are going to handle this case where it's not null, meaning we've already processed something and we've reached another specifier. So it means we need to wrap it up, we need to package that object and store it in our dictionary for later retrieval. Because we don't, we're done, we can, essentially, we'd be done. We can assume that we're done with the one we're currently working on. If it is null, which it is the first time around, then it doesn't execute this. So it doesn't store anything, because it hasn't processed anything. So, so we're kind of replacing, we'll replace it as we, we'll replace this current entry at each iteration of, at each specifier that we encounter, okay? So let's do it. So I don't know that we built the dictionary yet. Oh yeah, we did. So a loot category, this we want to replace with loot system entry, okay? And because we want it to be either a mob lookup or a mob type lookup or a loot category lookup. And there should be no conflicts between the two. In fact, I don't know if that's something we checked. Let me put the to-do here because we're going to want to do that. to do. Make sure loot cat you the user does not have a loot category name that conflicts with an item type or mob type. Because if it does conflict with something a type like a Chris, if I wanted to make a Chris, you remember that fencing weapon, that funny looking fencing weapon that I really always wondered, you know, how this little wiggly sword thing was like a good weapon. Anyway, you never see it on like, you know, medieval movies and stuff. I mean, I don't know. Maybe someone can find a movie that they have a Chris in it. I'd be interested to if you know of one. Anyway, this is supposed to be a dollar sign, and then have it spawn, a diamond in here, right? We don't want them to be able to specify a loot category that conflicts with an item type, because we want it to look up in RunUO the item. Whether there is an item type at the Chris object, right? And in the fencing weapon, you actually might, I don't know if I implemented it. No, I didn't. You're going to actually want a Chris item, and you don't want this to be interpreted as and overwritten by your custom loot category specification. I hope that makes sense. So anyway, I'm going to have to do that. So I'm going to put a to-do. I do that now and then to come back to it so I don't forget it. So that I don't lose my train of thought like I just did. So where are we? Okay, so we have our dictionary, and it's called loot category lookup. Loot category lookup dot add, and the string is going to be the remainder of this trimmed line, right? Dot substring. And then we don't need the length, so we're going to tell it to start on the first index of the trimmed line, so it's skipping the first character. So you'll notice this actually assumes that that we don't have anything else afterwards. So if we had weapon, this is silly, then you would have an entry that says weapon, this is silly, right? And I don't like that. I don't think that's a good idea. So maybe we ought to actually do a little test of whether or not this is a single entry, because if it's not a single entry, then they might enter this and it would be work in a very silly fashion. We don't like silly fashion approaches. We like smart approaches. So get me away from the whiteboard and I'll give you a real smart solution. but we'll give you my dumb solution up front, okay? For free. All right, so we want to do some tests, right? How do we figure out if there's anything after? And in fact, we could probably handle it. Last time I talked about regular expressions, and it's probably maybe the best approach is some sort of regular expression. But why don't I do it the hard-coded way, so you can kind of see how what's there's a simple solution. You ready? So this is not there in this loop or in this if statement. This if statement is simply, we've already figured out that this is this is the right one. You know, we should have already figured out and built our loot category object by the time we've hit this part here. Because everything in this code block is supposed to take everything that we've already built in the current entry, because we encountered a new entry and we're saying, oh, well, we encountered a new entry, time to store the entry where we're currently working on. So this is not the place to figure out from this string what the identifier is. We want to do that outside of here. So I'm going to do a split string, a string array equals loot category lookup dot split or dot I'm sorry, not loot category lookup. Trimmed line dot split. And there's a simple thing you can do here is because the split command returns a string array that contains the substrings, if you don't give it any parameters, then it splits on white space. So essentially we can determine in this simple fashion whether or not there's more than one entry. And we're going to use this in our mob specifier because we actually are going to split this one by white space, and we want it to have three entries that apply, three entries in the dictionary that apply to this loot category, right? So it's going to be the kind of the similar thing that we're going to do down there. So we split it up, and basically we want to see if split string dot length is greater than one, then Houston, we have a problem. Because it means that you had something, you know, something like that. Something. I don't know. It could be a lot of things. And why don't we test it? You know, it's always good to stop what you're doing. Test it. Make sure it kind of does what you're imagining it's going to do. I'm going to take that out. And let's throw a new exception. And our message in the exception, which is going to be displayed on the output, is Houston, we have a problem. I think this is going to run. I don't know. I don't think I broke it. Yes, it's running. So here we go. Here we go. It's compiling. Wait for it. Wait for it. Wait for it. Didn't have a problem. Oh, that's probably good because I don't think I have a problematic entry yet. Of course, the comment, as you recall, I handled. So by the time I reach, this stuff, it's been it's trimmed down to just include that. So why don't we enter a bad entry? So, and let's go. Up the test. It's faster now because it doesn't have to recompile. Encountered a problem. Uh-oh, Houston, we have a problem. Yep. You know, I was right. It happens every once in a while. This is going to be good. So basically, I'm going to tell them that you had a problem on this line. You can only have one identifier following the character. Okay, so we have created a feedback to the programmer or the person who's creating this loot table to tell them, all right, you can't do that, buddy. Don't be stupid. All right, so if we've gotten to this point, it means we did not have that error, and therefore we can take the trim line and do what I said before. Let's store it. String identifier equals trimmed line dot substring. We're starting at the first index because we want to skip the first character, and off we go with our. We have our identifier, so now it's time to create our new loot system entry. But it's not going to be just any loot system entry. It's going to be something a little bit more specific. It's going to be a loot category. All right, new loot category, and give it the identifier. But if we just say that, then we don't have any access to it later in the script, obviously. So we need to define a new variable to store it. New loot category. I'm very original, as you can see. Very original. So if it's all one word, of course, it doesn't interpret it as a new keyword. So you can do that. So by the time we reach this point, we have this nice new loot category object, which has a list of loot objects, which is currently empty, but has 10. You know, I told you last time about how it's actually an array, 10 long. And it has this identifier already set up. So if we wanted to know the identifier, we could do loot category dot identifier, right? And it should be whatever the identifier was. And why don't we do that? Why don't we say console dot write line my new loot category, and then new loot category dot identifier, and we can run it, and it will compile, and I will think about my next move while it's compiling. And you will see it print the new loot categories it's building every time it encounters one. Oh, of course you don't, because we still have a problem, Houston. Still have a problem. Try that again. All right, we got magic weapon one, weapon one of each, armor, food, archery weapon, fencing weapon, etc. Okay, you are architect, apparently on a different thread, because otherwise it wouldn't interrupt the flow. Different threads can do that, and that's why they're unpredictable. You don't know when they're going to jump in and do something. And that's why they're very difficult to program correctly, but very powerful if you know what you're doing. So, all right, we have our new loop category. I'm just going to close this object. Really, we're done with that. We don't even need to specify a new variable because we are going to make the current entry that new category, right? We already have a variable that we can store it for the current time, right? So we're going to store it there. And the next time it comes around, it actually will enter this if statement. And this is the time, my friends, that I'm going to take the current entry, which is the old entry. So if I've reached this point here, my current entry is this entry with the identifier magic weapon 1. And I'm going to add that current entry to the current entry identifier, right? One thing we're going to want to do, I'm going to want to make everything lowercase because I want that identifier to be independent of the... you know what? Before I do that, I want to add a helpful note to them to tell them what is the problem. Let's put that trim line in there so that the error message actually tells them this is the trouble spot. Very helpful. You want to add that stuff to your code so you can actually find what the problems are rapidly. Sorry to jump around like that. I'm like a squirrel, aren't I? Squirrel coder. We have this identifier. We want actually to not only do the substring, but you can actually chain functions because this function returns a string of its own. So we can add another function on the result of that. So we have the substring now. We're going to actually now to lower run that function on it, and that'll give us this lowercase identifier. Or did I already do that? I think I might have already done that up here. To lower. No, maybe I didn't. I probably should. Why don't I take care of it in the first place? It's a good idea. It's Canadian way. I'm not Canadian though. But I like to say A. Alright, so we have our new current entry. And that's all there is to that line, isn't it? Because really there's nothing else happening on these lines. There shouldn't be. And if there was, then it's going to have a problem. So we've handled that, and that's beautiful. So what happens next? Well, we got to handle what happens when you go into these, into the loot category, right? So first step is we are in the next iteration of the loop. So this is the end of the loop right here. I'm going to put a little comment here. End loop line loop. So it's going through each line of my file. So I come back here and we start the fun all over again. It trims the line, it checks for comments, takes out any comment, checks the first character. Okay. And we want to do the same thing again with the dollar sign. We want to, and in fact, rather than break here, which would take us to this point in the code, which we're now going to fill in with processing, you know, this kind of information. Why don't we actually continue? If I say continue, then rather than come out here of the switch statement, it's going to go to the beginning and run the next line, which is exactly what we want in that case, isn't it? So now we're processing the loot category specification. So let's start handling that stuff. We're just going to take it one at a time. So we're going to do a few things here. There's a few different possible outcomes. There is a case where there's this at symbol, and as I described in my very first broadcast a couple days ago, the at symbol is going to be an attribute specifier, okay? The attribute specifier is going to set an attribute. If I had my run UO open, which I can, I think, it's going to have to compile. I'm going to show you what kind of attributes you can change on an item. I think I showed it last time, but let's review it, and it's going to be important, obviously, to know what we're looking at. The question, how long have you been programming? Well, it all started back in 1999. Well, yeah, actually it was, when did I start programming? 2001 was when I was in high school and I took a Pascal class. I think I played around a little bit. Just my dad was a programmer. Oh, I did Razor again. Oh, this is fine. Okay, so we have here my server, and I have a longsword. I'm going to say props is the command. And we can, so these are all the attributes I want to have access to that I want to be able to have the loot system specify, like the damage level. That's one of the attributes, right? Damage level. So how long have I been programming? I programmed that year. I did a bunch of... I really got into like doing some games and stuff. Didn't do much with programming until I went to school. I did a bachelor's degree in electrical engineering, 2003. That's when I started that. And so I programmed in school. So I didn't specialize in it. I didn't take computer science. But after that, I did graduate school. I actually did a medical physics degree. And but I... had a part-time job for the first 2 years of that doctorate degree, and that part-time job was 20 hours a week. I was programming, it was flash programming. Actually, really learned a lot. That's really the way to learn programming, is just to like do it all the time. And anyway, after that, the carrots. You gotta have carrots, man. You go second age. You have to have carrots for, it's a good way to get stamina back in duels that you don't have potions, right? It's good stuff. Anyway, let's see, after that, mostly I was doing, in my research, I was programming in Python, and in my, then in my spare time, I was there's a game actually you can find a link to. I was doing some programming on this old adventure game interpreter system and whatnot. I mean, it's in years. I would say probably over the course of 6 years, I've programmed very significantly. Not a full time job. I've never been a full time programmer, but I love Ultima Online programming. I did that for a couple years, and it was a really good time. I learned a ton, but I'd say 6 years of various programming experience. I don't know that that's amazing, but I feel like I have enough to solve problems, and that's all it takes, is really the capability to solve problems. Think about the problem, or to have some enough experience to know what tools to use, to have, and really the ultimate skill if you want to be a good programmer is being able to search for answers when you run into a problem that you don't know how to approach. That's really helpful. So, great question. So let's see, where was I? So attributes. So we want to handle attributes. So we want to look for that first character, right? We have this first character test, and we have this case where the attribute is encountered. So what happens if an attribute is encountered? Well, we need an identifier again. Gotta stop my code. We're gonna trim this substring. We're gonna have the same issue. And in fact, why don't we write a function? If you're gonna copy and paste code, you know, we can copy this exact code. In fact, it doesn't like my using identifier twice because I already have defined an identifier variable. So why don't we pull that out of the loop, so it's available to every part of the loop, and delete the string declaration. So if you're gonna repeat code, you know, it's usually a good indicator that you should create a new function to do what you're doing. So why don't I do the single entry or single entry test to test this test string, and we can simply have a boolean, right? Oh, why don't we do this, and we're gonna do a boolean. Okay, so all we're gonna do is say return to test dot split dot length greater than 1. All right, so that is our single entry test. That is going to be our indicator that there's a problem. So we can do single entry test if single entry test or how about we even make it more specific? No, more wordy. Let's make it more wordy. Is single entry, right? So this function name kind of tells you it's going to return a boolean almost in and of itself. So is single entry, and we give it the trimmed line. Then we got this problem that we're going to throw the error. And in fact, we could do it even better, because otherwise we'd have this copy and paste down below. Let's get even cleaner. We love cleanness, cleanliness. Cleanliness is next to godliness, right? Here we go. Why don't we not even care of what happens, and why don't we throw the error in here? If that, then throw the error. And we don't need to return a boolean. You see what I'm doing? You smell what I'm thinking? You see what I'm saying? All right. And we don't put it in an if statement now. We just, and in fact, I think the correct term to use in such a case is something like assert single entry. Because we want to make sure it's a single entry. And if it's not, we're going to crash the system. So let's return that. Okay. There we go. That is beautiful. Everyone in the world can understand what I'm doing there, right? So let's, we want to assert it's a single entry on these attributes, because these attributes have specific things that are being set. I guess we maybe could build it so you could do, because for example, accuracy level and durability level, you might want to apply the same probability to each one of those, but maybe not. Let's not worry about that now. We'll do it what I had in mind, so that you'd have to specify it individually for each one, kind of assuming that the possible values that you can set it to are appropriate in here. or are specific to that attribute, right? It is possible, you know, these values are appropriate, are possible, the values for the accuracy level, of course, but we're not going to worry about that for now. All right, so we asserted the entry, we asserted that we got a single entry, so if we got here, then we're good to go with that. We're going to do the identifier after that, and we're going to need, I think I have a mob type specification, so a base loot object. So I don't have here a attribute object yet. Okay, so we're going to need one of those. So the spawn here doesn't actually mean, perhaps, it's maybe not the best word to use, but let's roll with it. Let's roll with it. So yeah, I'm helping a noob that's streaming on another channel instead of working on it. It's always hard to get the time to work on the things you want here. Let's see. There we go. So let's create an attribute object. And I spelled it wrong. No, I didn't. Okay, so let's create a new attribute object that we're going to put in the list of loot objects that is on our current entry. It's obviously going to break if I don't have a current entry. So if I had something like this, it's going to break. But it's going to throw an error that is probably going to be useful enough to figure out why. Maybe we can handle that situation another time. But let's new attribute object. Equals new attribute object. And let's give it, the attribute object is going to need an identifier, so let's navigate to that. And so the base loot object should have an identifier on it. Public string identifier. Otherwise, it is not going to be very useful. So now that I've defined that space to store a string on the base loot object, that means every one of these that inherit from base loot object have access to that. So my attribute object that I just created has an identifier on it. And let's even make it a little bit more enforced by requiring, because I think everything requires an identifier. So why don't we require the constructor like we did before to work, to require you to give me an identifier, otherwise I won't let you build a base loot object, okay? It's just a fundamental requirement. So now here I say identifier equals identifier. We got a problem because identifier refers, it'll give you a warning actually, because I have this identifier variable that I have access to in the scope of this, this function, right? But it conflicts with this one. And what happens when you have a local variable, which is only, you know, not accessible outside of any function but the one you're in, which this is could be considered a local variable, is it interprets every reference to identifier as the local one. But you can fix that by saying this dot identifier, which means this is the base loot object we're currently operating on, the one that we just built with this constructor, and this dot identifier will refer to that one. So little, hopefully not going too much into these program concepts that many of you may have awareness of without boring, don't want to bore you, but, there's, I think, viewers who aren't necessarily big programmers, so introducing it in some context, some ideas here. Okay, so we now have to, I think we actually have to do the same thing that we did here, where we now create constructors for each of these that follow suit. Copy paste. We're going to call the base constructor identifier. Okay. Not string. We're actually passing it as a parameter to that function, this function. So There we go again. Change this to that. And one more. Oh, we don't need this code in here, because that's what the base constructor does. And one more time, two more times. Bum, ba, da, copy, paste. And copy, paste. Alrighty. So now we have these that require, oh, trim line. It doesn't like trim line. To test is the line we want to print there. All right, we don't have a zero argument constructor. Of course you don't, because you just removed it. And we passed the identifier. So now we have this new attribute object. So why don't we add that attribute object to the current entry? Dot object, loot objects dot add new attribute object. Amazing. And in fact, now we're going to enter potentially the scope of the attribute object. Oh man, so we have two scopes here, right? We have this definition here, the scope of this definition, and that now we've hit this attribute object. I'm going to handle this one a little bit later. And we now are entering a new scope, because these lines here apply to the attribute object, okay? So let us create another an attribute object pointer, right? So we want to set that to the one we just created. And now, whenever we encounter something, we actually should be testing whether or not we're in an attribute object, or whether or not there is a current attribute object. And if there is, then we need to do something a little different. We should be adding entries like this into that attribute object, as opposed to the current entry, right? We don't want to add this stuff into this. We want to add it into that. Making sense? I hope so. All right, so we have this current attribute. So this is going to have, we're going to have to, our flow of logic is going to handle the fact that we now are in an attribute object. Okay, so the first character, we're going to run into there these brackets. Now the brackets have very special meaning, and I described that a couple videos or a couple days ago, and I'm obviously going to have to describe it again to implement it. But basically, I want it to mean that it will pick one and only one of the options inside of the bracket. Okay, so in this case, it would pick either a fencing weapon, sword weapon, macing weapon, or archery weapon. In the case of attributes, obviously, it can only pick one. You can't have it be 0 and 1 and 2. You can only have one of those options. So let's get into parsing, looking for this curly bracket, curly brace. So it's going to be a first character. It should be. If it's not, something's wrong. We're going to continue because we don't want to do anything after that. So this is where we're going to check. Is our attribute null? If it's null, then it means that we're not inside an attribute, because when we run into the closing curly brace, we're going to do that same test, right? If it's null, then do one thing. If it's not null, then it means we have an attribute we're working on. Okay, of course, not null. If it's not null, that's what that means. Else, we have an attribute we're working on, so we got to do something with that attribute. So if we have a closing curly brace, we want to, what? What do we want to do, everybody? We want to set it to null. Got a comment. This is discouraging me from learning to code. And I hope that that's not the case, but I recognize that it's a foreign language, you know, it really is. And, you know, you kind of have to learn the ropes, the way you learn a foreign language, which is practicing, you know, and practicing building stuff yourself. You know, a class is helpful. There's so many online tools and stuff that you could help you learn these days, though, that, you know, you take it a step at a time, you know, and you get discouraged. But I remember the first programs I wrote and how you'd get hung up on a semicolon, you know, and you'd have a semicolon. I remember writing, I had an exam in my first programming class where I had a for loop where basically the for loop just does a particular action a set number of times. Well, I mean, it can do more than that, but that's usually what you use it for. This statement basically means do whatever is in here for 10 iterations, right? And I accidentally added a semicolon right there. And you know what that does? It does nothing, basically runs through and changes I from 1 to 10. And then this is inside of, it would execute what's inside these brackets one time. Anyway, it took me forever to find that. Well, hours. It took me hours. And anyway. But yeah, normal run UO. So someone said normal run UO is much more simple. Yeah, if you want to do simple things, like if you want to change what this ogre here, you know, change him into a bird, and you can change his strength. You can change what happens when he spawns, you know, how much loot he has. You can make him breathe fire, you know, stuff like that. You know, a lot of things are simple. But when you want to build something brand new, you know, that's when the rubber hits the road, and that's where you really need to kind of have an understanding of how to logically approach the problem. Yeah, it's just about practice. So, yep. So let's continue, shall we? We're getting closer to the solution. So we're handling this case of we need to handle the entrance and the exit of the attribute object, right? So if the current attribute is null, then we're going to do something different. And that is we're going to handle this type of loop group. And I think I had, a group object. So that's a group object. So if it's this, then we're going to need to create a new group object. If it's null, so if we don't have an attribute we're operating on, let's create a group object. And then the identifier, it doesn't have one actually. So that's a weakness in my design. The base loot object doesn't have one. But I can pass null. I can tell it that this string, that this string or this particular base loot object doesn't have an identifier if we really wanted to. Not the cleanest thing in the world, but let's go ahead and do it. Let's run with it. So we're going to want to create a new group object, and we're going to want to, it's going to be the same deal. We're going to need to have a current group object. All right. So when we run into the closing bracket, we are going to handle it like so. In fact, the way that I implemented this with it equaling null is not what we want. We want it to do it like this. If it's not equal to null, then we want to set it to null. So we want to remove it. And otherwise, if current group object is not equal to null, then we set the current group object to null. Because it should be wrapping up, basically, right? But before we do that, you see, the attribute object we added at the beginning. And we can do that with the group object. The nice thing is if you add an object and then change the properties on that object, if you add an object to a list, which I have in this loop category, right? I have my loop category loot objects list. And you see down here, that's where I added my new attribute object when I first ran into this attribute object, right? afterwards, you can change all the properties on that object, and it actually, you know, the list still points to that object, so that object's properties are being updated. You don't have to, like, wait until the object is fully updated to where all the properties are all set into a particular state, and then you can then add it to a list. You know, you don't have to wait to do that. So we could here, when we run into this closing bracket, that could be where we wrap it up and we add it, but we don't have to do it that way. And in fact, so I don't want to do it that way. I want to add it as soon as I've encountered the group object specification, which is, like, for example, here. This is a group object because it's inside of a loot specification, a loot category, and it's not inside of a attribute. Okay, so we are going to now, let's take care of that before we finish the attribute stuff. So we have our loot category lookup. Not that, it's the, what did we add it to? The loot objects, current entry dot loot objects dot add group object. Okay, so that is handling this case. I'm like jumping over. This is all over the place, aren't I? I apologize, but that's kind of how, you know, you start to see, you know, as you're building the solution, you start to see, wait a second, I need to go back and fix that, and, you know, the logic has to make sense to the computer. So this is how it evolves, at least for me. I think for most people, but maybe there's some, like, ninja coders out there who don't have to ever go back. I don't think that exists, but okay. So if we're in this block here, then it means that we have an attribute, so we're doing something different. And really, we don't have to do anything because we know that we're working on an attribute. I guess what we could do is, it could be a test, basically, for whether or not we have whether or not the file format is being respected. I think it's very important to kind of enforce and notify the user when you aren't doing things according to the file format. So it is important to do something, though technically we know already that the upcoming lines have to do with an attribute object, if that makes sense. So here we go. We are going to basically add a Boolean this time. In attribute block equals false. So if we encounter a situation where we are inside an attribute, but we have not encountered a girly brace like this, then we want to do something. And so we need a flag. When I say a flag, a Boolean, either a true or false value, to tell us and to store that state and to tell us whether or not we are in that situation, right? So if we're in this else statement, we are in an attribute, so we are going to say true. But first, we should check if in attribute block throw new exception. Why? Why? P-A-R-T. Why? Because I gotta. Name that movie. All right. So the new exception is this attribute, and we can even tell you the identifier of the attribute we're working on, dot identifier. Attribute named such and such has a problem. It has more than one open brace in it. How do we know that? Because we're only going to allow this to become true even better, rather than just a true or false, why don't we keep track of the open curly braces encountered, so we can keep a running tally. Because we don't want them to do stuff like this, because that's garbage. That's stupid. Well, it might not be stupid. Aren't we having fun? It might not be stupid in here, because you can maybe say, you could have, so basically inside this group, right, it's going to pick one and only one of these. So it could pick one and only one of these. That would be stupid, though, because you could fix that. You could do that by creating a subgroup. So I'm gonna enforce that, where you can't do nested groups. Okay. I designed this file format, right? And I can decide what is allowed and what's not. So basically, I'm gonna say, if there's any situation, in fact, we don't even have to know whether we're in an attribute or not. We can, let's see, what's this? If you ever come across using kernel 32, just run. Kernel 32, I didn't catch the joke. Is it, across using kernel 32? Yeah, if you have a pointer, I'll have to look up the reference. Then I can be on the inside instead on the outside of the inside joke. Might be a Linux reference, something running, something that can destroy your system. I know there's certain things that really can do that if you are not doing something right. Open curly braces +++. Okay, so as soon as we encounter an open curly brace, we want to basically increment this variable that tells us how many curly braces we've encountered. And when we find a closing curly brace, we want to subtract one from that because they should have matching pairs, right? And then we can check if open curly braces encounter is greater than one, because if we encounter two in a row, like in here, right, then throw a new exception. Too many curly braces. And, you know, we could even keep track. Let's do this. I had this thought earlier that we could actually do, instead of removing the empty lines, right, when I split on the new lines, you know, of the file. So I have the file text, and I'm splitting on the new lines and processing line by line. Rather than remove all the empty entries, why don't I not do that and keep track of the current line number? And every line, add increment that line number. And then we have something in these error messages where we could even say, so again, these are things that are keep your code cleaner. Why don't we make a function that throws the error and adds the line number to it so that it's cleaner? And I'm going to show you how to do that. So like this, assert empty, or assert single entry. Blow up. And we're going to have a line number. And we're going to have a message. So rather than in every case doing throw new exception and then typing a current line number, what did I call it? Oh, I'm not in the right loop here. Rather than having the exception have the current line number plus and adding this line number, blah, you know, rather than doing that, why don't I create a function that kind of does that for me? Throw new exception. It'll be a lot cleaner that way. Line number, colon, and then message. All right, so now every time I have a new exception, so that's a weakness of this regular expression approach, is I don't know the line number, but that's okay. I think this is enough information for you to, you know, it calls you a doofus and everything, so I think it's enough. Then we come down here and we can, anytime we encounter this throw no exception, we will do blow up line number and then the message, right? It doesn't exist. It's called current line number. So I'm going to copy this, paste it wherever there is a exception being thrown. So I think we're good. So, you know, there's other approaches you can do. You can have like a debug. These are kind of design choices, but you can have a debug.log approach where the string, so if I wanted to run the server and have it not print these messages, you can have like a debug level that you could change on the fly if you wanted. So you have a debug level 2 where it prints all the stack traces and the exception messages in the console. But what if you're getting lots of errors? Then that actually can slow your server down. So you could change it to debug level 1, and you could, in this function, I could handle, you know, I could not print the line numbers, you know, depending on the debug level, or, you know, things like that. You can do some cool stuff, some cool, you know, controls for what information you want to be printing and not printing, depending on whether or not you're debugging or not, stuff like that. All right, so we don't have this in attribute block anymore. Because, let's see, do we? We're going to do this curly brace thing. So really, the curly bracing happens here. So it takes care of this case where there's too many curly braces. Otherwise, there's more than one curly brace in it. So we don't need that information. So, if the current attribute is null, then we add a group object. Otherwise, we actually don't really do anything. We don't care. It doesn't. The important thing is that there's not more than one in there, right? Is that what I said? I think that's what I said. All right. So we've implemented this curly brace. So now we're in the meat of the attribute object. So the attribute object is going to need some special data containers for its information, like for each of these entries. It needs to keep track of all the entries inside of it so it knows what options there are. So we have this attribute object, and the attribute object itself has an identifier in it, but we need more of the information than just the identifier. It needs a list as well. A list of strings, okay? Possible entries or possible outcomes, okay? And we can go ahead and make a new list of strings. We'll go ahead and give it a starting length of 5. Why not? And you don't have to do that. You can do that, and it'll work magically and automatically make the list longer as it goes. But so now we have this possible outcome list on this attribute object. So in our parser, we're going over each line. We've encountered that. So now we hit continue. It basically ignored it because it's fine. It doesn't have any curly braces. Or it has encountered a curly brace inside the attribute object. So now I have, my current state is that I have a current attribute object, and I am now on this line. It says 0, right? So how am I going to process that, right? Well, so we're going to add to the line number. We're going to trim the line. We're going to do all that comment stuff. Okay, this is where the line processing begins. So just so you know, we've trimmed it up. This is all the processing, you know, just kind of behind the scenes. We don't need to. It's not the important stuff. Now we have our first character. We're going to check again whether or not it has a particular character in it. If we encounter this closing bracket, then there is this no. Then it will. And the current attribute is not null, meaning it exists. We have a current attribute, then it's going to set it to null. And of course, decrement this. And we actually need it to blow up if this is less than zero, right? Current line number. Because it means you encounter two closing brackets before, you know, you gotta have an opening bracket for or a brace for every closing brace, right? 30 minutes left in the stream. We're making progress. Maybe not quite as fast as I envision. I'm maybe a little optimistic, but we're gonna get through this. I think pretty quickly. Almost certainly, I think by the end of next stream we're gonna have this loot system working, and it's gonna be pretty beautiful. So we're going to encounter the closing bracket without, or but not enough opening braces. All right, nice, helpful message. Okay. All right, so we are now ready. If we encounter this, it's going to continue because we obviously don't do anything if it's a... So continue, which means go to the next line because we don't do anything if it's comment. That's comment. If it encounters that, it's time to do a new loot entry, a new... a new category entry. And if we're in the middle of an attribute, then we got a problem because what might have happened is you have this closing brace after, and so your current attribute has not been completed, and clearly if I haven't finished specifying what's in this attribute, then I don't want to start processing the next loot category, right? So if this is not null, meaning it exists, that catches some people. If it's not equal to null, if it exists, that's the same thing as saying if it exists. You could also do if it's equal to null, do one thing, otherwise do another, but I like doing if not equal to null. If it's been assigned to something, then we need to throw or blow up. We got to blow up because current line number encountered specifier with while in the middle of an attribute specification. And we can even tell them what our current attribute is. Identifier. Alright. So we want to blow up, and it won't continue executing because the blow up throws an exception, and that exception stops the execution there and comes down to here and runs this code, okay? All right, so we've handled that case. If there's an ampersand, we got the same problem. Okay, if there's an at symbol, we got the same problem. But this again is this copy and paste thing. I don't know that we could make this any smaller. We could do assert no attribute. And then, but let's not do that. Let's just copy and paste. Sometimes I'm lazy, you know. Sometimes I don't do it as beautifully as it could be done, because I could make a function that asserts that there's no current attribute, right? But so at the beginning of this at symbol, I want to check if there's a current attribute, because there shouldn't be one. But if we encounter that, because we should have run into this closing brace before, and that closing brace sets that current attribute to null. So it should not exist anymore. So this would say, oh, it's null, so I don't run this code. All right, so we are pretty much good to go in that case. So we now have reached... no special characters encountered. Otherwise we would have... Oh, and this should be continue, because we don't want it to break. This will be continue as well. We don't want it to break out of the switch statement, and continue executing in any of these cases. These are these special cases that we handle specially. So now we have reached this point, and this is where we start to look at these entries. So there's a few different scenarios, and we've been trying to, along the way, if you've been kind of paying attention, we've been trying to enforce these different scenarios along the way, that basically you shouldn't be inside, or you shouldn't be processing this loot category if you're in the middle of an attribute object, right? So anyway, let's handle those situations. If the current attribute is not equal to null, sorry if that bothers you, current attribute is not equal to null, then we want to do one thing, because whatever the line is, if we're on the zero, applies to that current attribute. It does not apply to the current current entry, loot system entry, which is happens to be a category in this case. So if current entry doesn't equal, if current group doesn't equal to null, then of course the lines correspond to the group, right? So again, the difference between the difference between attribute group and one of these spawning groups is just whether or not there's an attribute object right before it, right? So anyway, the other case is if current entry doesn't equal null, then we want to add to this current entry. So this is an example of a current entry. So when I run into this line that has no special symbols in front of it, I'm going to try to add the plate armor to that entry. Okay? It's a question. Hey man, where do you originally get the current attribute from? I came in after that. Okay. So current attribute is in my loot specification. So I have this custom file format, and I have in my custom file format for this loot specification, I can define attributes using the at symbol. And so that happens in this special case. So I'm basically processing this file format line by line, this file, you know, built in this format, line by line. I come across an at symbol, and basically there shouldn't be a current attribute at the time I do that. And basically this is where I assert that everything is, there's only one entry, so I don't have like extra stuff in here. And then I grab the identifier, which is damage level in this case, and I grab the, and I build, make a new attribute object, set that current entry attribute object. So for the switch statement, okay, hold on one sec. Are you publishing as open source? Yes, I am going to publish this loot system open source, so anyone can access it and play with it. And for the switch statement, yes, the switch statement is the first character of the line after it's been cleaned up by this stuff here. I trim the line, I get rid of the white space on the edges, and I make it all lowercase, and I get rid of any comments. So, hello. Alright, so I was thinking, can you check for the null current attribute before the switch statement to avoid copying the if it's null in each case? Great question. So I could, but I'd almost need a switch statement in and of itself. So it'd be like, if current attribute isn't null, then we got to switch on the first character, right? And basically we can do it where if we run into these particular symbols, then, so yeah, this is actually, I like that. Why don't we do it? It's actually a much cleaner solution. Thank you for the suggestion. If we run into these particular symbols, and we don't even need to break, because we know that, well, the compiler doesn't know that it's going to throw an exception. Or does it? I don't know. Maybe it will. If you don't put breaks in there, then the compiler closes. In fact, we can even do it this way. With a switch statement, you can have several things pop into the same result, or same code, which is one of the beautiful things of a switch statement. And we're going to blow up And the message is this. And where did I go? Oh, there we are. Paste that message in there. And we can actually even, now it's more elegant because we can just use the first character in there instead of, you know, hard coding each one individual case. So now, oh, this feels so nice. You know, I love deleting code and making it more beautiful. It makes you feel so good inside. There we go. All right. I like that. Thanks for the suggestion. In fact, one thing you can do to kind of clean up stuff. So you already speak about run your own. I already talked about how to run your own server. You can find that at the beginning of this broadcast, which is archived on Twitch. And I'm probably going to put it on. But yeah, I already have the server. This is the RailPoor free shard that we're planning to reboot that I'm working on. So this system I'm building will work in any vanilla run UL. But anyway, let's call this a region, and we're going to do current attribute. And then you can do end region. And this lets you, in Visual Studio, collapse it into current attribute check. So, and in fact, why don't we do the same thing here? Nice. Let's call it cleanup string. And we gotta tell it this is the end of the region. And now we can collapse that, so we don't even have to look at it anymore. Of course, this is where the line processing begins. It's like at the very beginning of the loop. Not really. But anyway. So, there we go. We are going to... Where are we? Here we are. No special characters have been encountered. Got 20 minutes in this stream. Where can we get with the 20 minutes left? We got okay, so it should handle it basically the same way, regardless of what. Well, so we have this identifier basically. We have some kind of identifier on a single line. It could potentially have a probability to it. It could potentially have a reference to one of our other categories, the fancy weapon category, like this one. Or it could be in and of itself an item in run UO, an item type. So, I can use your server for test. Yeah, you can use the run UO, the serve UO server that I pointed to. If you would like to play around with this stuff, but yeah, absolutely. I showed you how to run it and showed you how to get the project in Visual Studio and everything, so it should be good. All right, so we want to grab a line. We have the line. It doesn't have to be a single entry, so we don't have to assert it as a single entry because it might have multiple entries as when split on the white space. In fact, we want to support multiple entries. So what we want to parse it into is, so for in the different scenarios you have, in any of these scenarios, whether you're inside this attribute specification, you can have these different probabilities, right? You shouldn't have the amount modifier. You know, I have this times 4 or times 100 to 200, you know, random specifier of between some range 100 to 200. You can't have that in the attribute specification, right? We don't want to have them typing something like that in there. So we're going to have to take care of that. The other thing is that's the only difference though, really. And I think what we'll do, so it might be interesting to actually grab, this actually might be an interesting thing to try to implement, and I think we could do it. I might have to think on it a little bit for the next time. But where we have this identifier, and we're going to assume that that identifier is going to apply to whatever object came before it, right? And that that object may or may not have a property on it named damage level. If inside the weapon specification I had cheese in here, then there's a chance that this weapon specifier would spawn a piece of cheese, and I'd try to set the damage level on it, and it would not work. So one thing we could implement using reflection is fun, is a something that goes through basically after we've built we'd have to pass through a couple times though probably to actually do this, but it would go through and actually check every entry inside weapon, which might have its own entries, you know, fencing weapon or whatever, and check every entry in there so that the item type, so you come over to, you know, every item type that spawned in those entries conforms to this particular attribute. That could be quite a bit of work, and you know, ultimately it's going to have to happen at the end after we've gone through everything, because I don't know yet exactly what's inside of this weapon specifier while I'm processing this attribute. So I don't know whether this is an appropriate, or whether this damage level is an appropriate property of a fencing weapon, or of this, you know, whatever spawned from this weapon, right? So anyway, that is an aside, but so we're going to have to handle a given entry here. So first step, and I think we're going to have to do this for any attribute, is we're going to split string array, split string equals trimmed line dot split. So that's going to give me an array that has every entry split with white space, right? So it'll be a nice way to determine how many, if there's this percent thing in there or not, or if there is this extra modifier in there or not, right? So one thing we could do is handle each case separately. There's really only three modifiers. Question, is this how RunUL serializes the data when it saves, or does it use XML? It uses XML for some things. It uses just binary data for most of the most things. So it would store, you know, all the name of the character as binary, you know, as a string with a null terminated string, or it would have all these integers and stuff representing the hit point maximums, and I mean everything's binary except for, I think, like the accounts are stored in an XML file. This thing I'm working on right now is like a configuration file in my own file format to give you, do a demonstration, kind of a programming demonstration, but also I think this file format is cleaner. You know, it's a very specific application, so it's a two-pronged thing. You know, I want people to see how you would approach this programming problem, and I would like also to have a nice clean configuration file that we can specify all the loot tables in, and edit and change and reload all these loot tables on the fly and all these things, so while the server's running. So that's kind of the goal. All right, so we have this split string. In this case, that split string will have a zero in it, then nothing else. So we are going to do something with it. We're implementing the current attribute right now, so let's focus on that section of these possible outcomes, right? So we need to do some tests. Is there, we need to iterate over each entry. So why don't we do a for each string? You know, you run out of specifiers that are really nice. You know, I want to use entry. I want to use like value. I don't know. What should I use? Any ideas? Token. How about a token? There's two tokens in here. token sounds nice. In split string. All right, for each token in the split string, let's do some tests. If token.contains a percent symbol, and in fact, what we could do is even is we could do like a regular expression. I don't think that that's absolutely necessary, and it probably is faster to not do it. Marginally, not a whole lot, especially if I'm using the .contains function. But really, so we should have a actually, let's do it like this. Not a regular expression. We don't need a regular expression here. If token dot last character. No, that's not what I'm looking for. If token and then token the character at token dot length minus one. So what am I doing here? Basically, if I have a string. Hello is my string, and that's in token. Okay, then what this would do is it would grab the length of token, which is 5. There's 5 characters in token. You have to subtract 1 because it's a 0 indexed character array, basically, right? So you would say 5 minus 1 is 4. So the fourth character, this is the 0th character, the first character, the second, the third, and the fourth. So zero, or not zero. There is zero. Hello at a zero. Hell zero. Hello. Okay. So this would return a zero, a O, right? So in my case, if I had 65%, then this would return 3 minus 1 is 2. So this is 0th character, first, second. So this would return a percent sign, if it equals a percent sign. All right. So if token.length minus 1, token at token.length minus 1 is a percent symbol, then we want to do one thing. If it's not a percent symbol, then we should assume that whatever the entry is a valid entry for that particular attribute. We are not going to worry about this. And we are not going to, at this time, we could maybe come back later to make this a more powerful loot system in terms of telling the user when they've screwed up. Again, as I described, checking whether what are possible values here. If I had this Farfenugen, I don't know how to spell Farfenugen. That's a German word for family-friendly fun or something like that. I asked a guy once. But I think it's like the Volkswagen motto. But if I had something in here that wasn't a number, and that's obviously not a valid thing, right now I actually am going to say, I don't care. I'm going to expect the user to know what a valid value is and deal with that later. But at some point, I think I'll implement some checks. It'll be like, hey, you can't set a damage level to Farfenugen. What are you thinking, you doofus? And I can even insult you. That's always an enjoyable experience for some reason. All right, so I insult me, actually. I will insult myself because I'm going to be using this loot system. All right, so otherwise, we just want to store whatever that value is in our loot system entry. So we have our attribute object. So the possible outcomes are is a list of strings. Something that's missing, though, is the list of probabilities. So there's a couple ways to implement this. I could have a parallel list and simply know that this list is going to be the exact same. I can just call it probabilities, and it's a list of we can do a list of doubles. Okay. Doubles are decimal characters or decimal values, like that's a double, right? Anyway, and just keep track of it. I just know that they're going to have they're parallel because when I add an outcome, which is in this case, the outcome is 0, and I add a probability 60%, and then I go on to the next line and I add an outcome 1 and an outcome and the probability 30%. I know that the first element in the probabilities list, it corresponds to the first element in the outcome list. And that's okay. But I don't know that I like that solution as much as doing something like a struct. A struct or class, there's a few subtle differences. If you're interested in it, you can look it up. But this is we're going to be using this for, I think, every entry here. So we might as well build a data structure, something to hold these three values all in one spot. It's a much simpler thing. There's a tuple. Oh, yeah, we could do a list of tuples, you know. Yeah, why don't we do that? I think I actually haven't used that before. Why don't we try that? I haven't done that before. Vorspire has suggested a list of tuples. So they are string and double. Okay. And so tuples are clearly a simple data type, and it's a generic one, so you can tell it, I want you to hold a string and a double. And let's do that. So it's like I created my own data type, but I didn't. It's not as cool. A little messier, maybe, but not bad at all, I don't think. So we are going to do now, so we have this possible outcomes. And, well, let's see. We want a string, a double, and potentially, but for attribute objects, that's all we need, a string and double. But eventually, we're going to actually want a string, a double, and then something for my, you know, amount modifier, right? This x4 and x, or x100 to 200 if it's on gold. I don't know where, yeah. So that tuple might not quite cover that. We can do, I think a tuple can do more than one. Yeah, you can do many, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, rest, 8 or greater. Wow, you can do many different ones. So we could do a 4 tuple. Again, maybe not the cleanest and easiest to understand, but, you know, let's roll with it for this case. How's that? Rather than define our own data type. So we have come here. If we have encountered a percent symbol, then we actually want to grab whatever is before that percent symbol, which is this, we assume. And we will go, oh, by the way, this exception thing, I think our line number, we could put outside. For some reason, I don't know why I just thought of this. Put it outside of the try statement. Then the catch statement actually has access to it. On line, current line number. So then we don't actually even need to include the line number. And the reason I just thought of that is because I am going to be parsing. I'm going to tell the computer, I want you to give me a number. So, oh, gotta go. All right, sounds good. I'm ending the stream actually in just a few minutes. So I'm actually going to be parsing this this value. I'm going to tell the computer, hey, I'm going to give you this string of characters. I want you to give me a number back, okay? And that can be problematic if, for example, the user did something like, how about this? 6-0. Or, I don't know, the user can do silly things or make a mistake. Maybe they had a typo, you know? And the computer will be like, I don't know how to do this, you know, I don't know how to change this into a number, and it's going to throw an exception, and this code here, of course, is going to catch the exception, and it's going to tell us the current line number, which is really nice information to know, and I don't even need to implement my own handler for it. I can just assume it's right, execute the code, and there you go. Execute the code to parse it, to tell the computer, I want you to take these characters and make me a number, and you have the answer. And if it's input incorrectly, it'll come out here and tell them what they did wrong. So I like that. I like that a lot. So let's take the token. Let's grab the substring of it. Of basically 0 to token.length minus 1. So that'll take us right up to the edge of being a percent symbol, right? And we're going to take that. we got to do something with that. So right now we have 6-0 in a string format. So let's say int.parse. That is the function that is available anywhere in my code because it's part of the C# library to parse it into an integer. Now we need to store that. Probability equals that. And now the current attribute. Okay, so we're on a single line. The single line should have everything in the tuple that we need. And so we can actually create the tuple here. And it's a string and double. Probability and, wait, no, it's something in probability. It's the identifier and probability. You got to initialize it with something. So we'll initialize the double with negative 1.0, and the string we're going to initialize with an empty string. But we'll change it. So it is time for me to get going. Why don't we finish this particular thing we're working on. Item 1 is a string equals, we're not doing the string there, identifier and probability dot item 1, item 2, that's the probability, this is double, is the probability divided by 100.0, which automatically converts it to a double because when you take an integer and you divide it by a double, it converts it to a double first and then does a division and gives you a double out. And that, oh, it's read only. Ah, not mutable. Okay, so we are going to have to grab that information, store it like this. We're going to do the identifier to spawn or to execute, and we're going to do the probability. We're going to put 0, 1, and this is going to be null. Okay, so we're going to set the probability here. There's a conflict here. There's a probability integer. Comes from the string, and I store it in this probability object. And then otherwise, we want to store the identifier to execute equals token. All right. So by the time we've gotten out of this for each loop, we have stored here something. If identifier to execute can't be nothing. It's not possible. It's not possible. If it is nothing, then I'll eat my hat. Just joking, I will not. But it shouldn't happen, ever. So now we can create our tuple because we have the things we're going to put in it. New tuple string, tuple or tuple, I don't know. And the probability. And now we can assign to the current attribute, or we can add dot possible outcomes dot add the tuple we just created. And now we have essentially stored all of these lines that correspond to an attribute. So I'm going to run at one debug session, and let's see if we actually get in here. I hope that we do, because if we don't, we're going to have to fix it. Oh, it doesn't like that. Line 278. Ah, how did that happen? You guys didn't catch it for me. That's okay. Maybe you did, and you just were quiet about it. Wanted to see me suffer and fail. That's a good time. Yeah. It's kind of like when you're watching me code and you're like, oh, what is he doing? Is that's stupid. Hey, we're in here. That's awesome. It's like, you know, on those sitcoms and you see something that's just so embarrassing, you just feel for him and you're like, oh, I need to be that person right now, you know. I don't know. Let's see. So we are executing through. This is my split string. It has one element in it. It has zero in it, which it does. Let's go through and... okay, well, let's keep going. So I got my identifier to execute a zero. There's no more tokens in there. I got my new tuple. It has zero with a negative one probability. We're going to actually use that negative one because the probability should never be negative one unless it's dependent on how many elements there are on that list. That's something I'm going to build into that. That's the file format. And then we added it to the possible outcome, so that's the first count. I'm going to execute this a couple times. And finally, possible outcomes has three possible outcomes. Nope. Oh, whoa. Oh, this is. Oh, okay. I executed enough to get into this section. So I'm on this first section, and indeed, we have this tuple. The first tuple is zero, and it has a 0.6, which is 60% probability. How's that, everybody? What I'm looking for, you know, what is it? No, is it what's the right thing to do at this point? I don't know. I feel good inside that it did what I imagined it would do in my mind, and that's the beautiful thing about programming is you think of what you expect it to do and you give it the instructions and it does and it's magical. So thanks for joining me today. And tomorrow I will be fleshing out the rest. I think it's going to be very similar. Obviously, the identifier, this approach here that I have is very similar to all these other approaches, or these other things. I think it's going to roll along pretty well. Good probability. Maybe I'll give you a 50% chance that we're going to get the thing done tomorrow in 2 hours, but I don't know. I start talking and stuff, and we'll see if it actually happens. But thanks for joining me. I hope it was interesting for you, and I will hopefully see you tomorrow. Bye bye. Where's that button? I gotta turn off that button.